The British aircraft industry from the latter part of World War I up until the 1950s was one of the biggest in the world, with a large number of manufacturers building some of the most iconic planes of the time, as well as creating groundbreaking technologies like the jet engine and onboard radar. So how did such a great heritage end up like a Greek tragedy? On the one hand, with the decimation of the native aircraft industry, and yet on the other, with the UK growing to have one of the largest national aerospace industries in the world. The decline of the British aviation industry can be traced back to the end of the war. By then, Britain was pretty much broke, but there were still about 70 aircraft manufacturers, many of which were small and scattered around the country. Whilst this decentralised approach to manufacturing suited wartime production and the threat from bombing, after the war there was too much duplication in the industry, and the lack of orders made many of these companies unviable. Through takeovers, mergers and bankruptcies, by the 1960s this number had dropped dramatically. But it wasn't just market forces which brought about the closure of many businesses, but also the action of the British government itself, through what can only be described as incompetence, ignorance, political dogma, and belief by some in Whitehall that everything American was superior. This can be exemplified by the case of the Miles M52, a turbojet-powered supersonic research aircraft developed from 1942 to 47, in accordance with a secret Air Ministry specification E24/43. This was to build a supersonic aircraft capable of 1600 kilometers an hour, or 1000 miles an hour, and be able to climb to 36,000 feet or 11,000 meters in 1.5 minutes. This would be at the cutting edge of technologies like aerodynamics and engine design, and would launch Britain into the supersonic age. The M52 was on course to become the first supersonic jet by the end of 1946, but with a project at over 80% complete and final tests just a few months away, the new Labour government under Clement Attlee cancelled it, originally on grounds of cost, but also because the Director of Scientific Research at the Ministry of Aircraft Production, Benjamin Lockspicer, the man who actually cancelled the project, thought that planes were years away from flying supersonically, or if it was even possible. After the news broke, there was public outcry, and the project was revived in 1947, but with scale models instead of full-size prototypes. And just a few days before, a test flight of a scale version M52 that reached Mach 1.38, Chuck Yeager in the US broke the sound barrier in the Bell X-1. However, what wasn't well known at the time was that the British government had given the M52 research to the US in 1944 on the understanding that high-speed research should be shared, though no such data was forthcoming back from the US. Unknown to the British, the Bell Aircraft Company were given access to the research and came up with their own version, but it had instability problems with the fixed tail. The Miles team had already come to the conclusion that an all-moving tail would be the solution. When Bell switched to the same all-moving tail design, the instability issue was fixed and the sound barrier was broken. Soon after, the M52 program was cancelled for good, with the stated reason that the cost was too high for too little return, though follow-on programs would eventually lead to the English Electric Lightning, capable of a Mach 2.27 in 1959. It wasn't until 1955, some 8 years later, that the British government finally acknowledged that the cancellation of the M52 program had seriously set back the British progress in the field of supersonic design and aeronautical progress in general. This certainly wasn't the first time that government officials had failed to understand the potential of advanced aviation ideas. Frank Whittle patented the jet engine in 1930, 7 years before the Germans ran their first jet engine. But it took until 1939 before the Air Ministry finally were convinced of the importance of his work. Now, whilst cancellation was an essential tool of the procurement process to weed out bad programs, ministerial short-sightedness and the willingness to cut costs without understanding the implications had the effect of destroying even good programs. But what would come a few years later would deal a hammer blow to the British aviation industry. In 1957, the government published the now infamous White Paper on Defence, in which it thought that the British aircraft industry was in need of a major reorganisation as it was deemed to be inefficient with too much duplication. Although there had been mergers and takeovers, the government wanted to force the remaining companies to merge into larger conglomerates by only issuing new contracts to newly merged companies. Those that didn't follow the plan would be shut out of government money. The paper was also heavily influenced by the rapidly developing space and missile technologies of the day. Duncan Sandys, the then Minister of Defence, stated in the paper that the era of manned combat was at an end and that high-speed interceptors and high-altitude bombers would be redundant with the advent of surface-to-air missiles and intercontinental ballistic missiles, a view which became thoroughly discredited in the following years. However, the effect was to stop many advanced aircraft programs dead in their tracks. Aircraft which would have been a major boost to the industry and economy with export sales if they had gone ahead. The Sanders Roe SR-177 was one such plane, which not only combined jet and rocket power to give it an exceptional rate of climb, but also had an advanced interception radar that could scan for targets and lock onto them. Whilst the SR-177 was in the running to become the new NATO frontline interceptor for Europe, with Germany set to place orders, Aubrey Jones, the Minister of Supply, had agreed to continue funding for 5 of the 6 prototypes and assured the Germans that everything was fine. Unbeknownst to Jones, Duncan Sandys also contacted the Germans and said the project was effectively dead. These confusing messages from the British government and the subsequent changes in the German Air Ministry's requirements eventually led to the SR-177 being dropped in favour of the Lockheed F-104 Starfighter. Again, what wasn't known at the time was that Lockheed had paid $22 million in bribes and sales incentives to German, Italian, Dutch and Japanese officials to secure the so-called deal of the century. When this was made public, there was outrage in Europe and the US. The deal very nearly collapsed Lockheed and was hugely embarrassing to the US, which soon after banned any such payment to foreign government officials. The only aircraft project to survive the White Paper was the English Electric Lightning, because that was deemed to be too far in its development to cancel. Although the war focused all the efforts of the British aviation industry on military aircraft, there was still a realisation that after the war, Britain would need new civilian aircraft for transport around the Empire and Commonwealth. In 1942, the Brabazon Committee was set up to look into this and came to the conclusion that the massive infrastructure that had been created in the US to build bombers and military transport could be readily converted to build future civilian aircraft, which the British and Commonwealth countries had little experience in the design and manufacture of, and therefore would be forced to buy American. It was recommended that an interim conversion of bombers including Lancaster, Lincoln and Halifax should be done into civilian airliners, but also that 7 new types of aircraft be developed from short-hop versions to transatlantic airliners to fly popular routes like from London to New York. Of all the Brabazon designs, the most adventurous and risky of these would become the de Havilland Comet, the world's first jet airliner. The design was so advanced that de Havilland had to develop both the airframe and the engines, because in 1945 there were no turbojet engine manufacturers anywhere in the world working on a design that was powerful enough or economical enough for transatlantic flight at a proposed altitude of 40,000 feet. The Comet first entered service in 1951, and by 1953, Popular Mechanics wrote that Britain had a 3 to 5 year lead over the rest of the world in jet airliners. Although during the design, the Comet was subject to the most rigorous tests of any contemporary airliner, it was still the first aircraft of its type, and many of the features of the advanced design had not been tried in service before, so it was effectively a flying testbed, which the rest of the world looked to for not only for inspiration, but also to see if there were going to be any flaws. But in 1953, the first of three fatal crashes due to structural issues grounded the entire Comet fleet. After intensive pressure testing in a custom-made water tank, it was found that the stress created around the corners of the large square windows was much higher than expected. This combined with less than perfect holes from punch riveting instead of drilled riveting, and a repeated pressurization at altitude caused metal fatigue and then cracks to form in the airframe, which in time led to the catastrophic decompression at altitude and the loss of the aircraft. In the years that followed, the Comet was redesigned, but Britain's lead in the airliner business was lost. All the existing Comet orders were cancelled, which allowed the Boeing 707 and the Douglas DC-8 to catch up and avoid the mistakes of the Comet. Although the Comet was the first transatlantic jet airliner, by the time the Comet 4 returned to the market in 1958, the American 707 and DC-8 were larger, faster, cheaper, and more economical to run. Even though other technically advanced British-built airliners were launched in the 1960s, including the Vickers VC-10, the Hawker Siddeley Trident, and the BAC-111, none of them could compete with the dominance of the American manufacturers. As the 1970s and 80s came around, it looked like the British aviation industry might go the same way as its car and motorcycle industry, with the remaining businesses consolidating and gradually moving away from the design and building of complete aircraft to becoming partners in multinational programs like the Sepiket Jaguar, the Panavia Tornado, and the Eurofighter Typhoon. By the time we get to 1999, what was left of the old aviation companies, namely the General Electric Company and British Aerospace, were finally rolled into one with the formation of BAE Systems. And in 2006, they sold their 20% share of Airbus, which it had inherited from British Aerospace. And this saw the end of UK-owned civil airliner production. Now, whilst BAE Systems may have pulled out of assembling complete aircraft, they've diversified across the military sector and have grown to become not only Britain's biggest military supplier, but also Britain's largest manufacturer and the third largest military contractor in the world. No other defence company covers such a broad range of platforms and services, including everything from warships to armoured vehicles to aircraft to advanced intelligence and cyber operations. Only Boeing and Lockheed Martin are larger. Through acquisitions of US defence contractors like United Defence and Armour Holdings, BAE Systems is now one of the largest defence contractors to the US Department of Defence, with over 30,000 workers in the US alone. They are also the only non-US military supplier allowed to participate in the Pentagon's most sensitive technology programs, not least the F-35 Joint Strike Fighter, as well as other top secret cyber and intelligence work. The other British success story is Rolls-Royce. Again, through mergers and acquisitions of not only major players in the British aero engine industry, but also international acquisitions like the American Allison Engine Company, Rolls-Royce has grown to become the second largest maker of aircraft engines in the world after General Electric, and is a major player in the marine power systems and power generation, and is also a supplier to the F-35 project. So from the dark days of the past, the British aviation industry has morphed into a world-leading aerospace and defence industry. Quite a turnaround from the 1950s. It's used its technical expertise and ingenuity to becoming a world leader by proxy, by supplying the parts and systems that go into what was the competition. With new groundbreaking technologies like the Sabre hypersonic hybrid air-breathing rocket engine, developed by ex-Rolls-Royce engineers, and which could revolutionise the future of air travel with hypersonic speeds, to the announcement of the sixth generation Tempest fighter project being developed in cooperation with the UK Ministry of Defence, BAE Systems, Rolls-Royce and Italian Leonardo SPA, it looks like the future could be even brighter for the British aerospace industry. So thanks for watching, and don't forget to please subscribe, thumbs up, and share.